Hello, B here, and welcome back to Integrated Physics and Chemistry. Have you ever heard the saying, opposites attract? This phrase is based on the physics law of attraction. If you have an object with a positive charge near an object with a negative charge, they will be naturally attracted to each other. Conversely, like charges, such as two positive charges or two negative charges, will naturally repel each other. This law of attraction is the basis of how the ions we learned about in our last lesson form ionic bonds, which form ionic compounds, or salts. But before we get started, let's look at our goals for this lesson. By the end, you'll be able to discuss how ionic bonds are formed, determine the formula of an ionic compound, determine the name of an ionic compound. In our last lesson, we learned how atoms gain or lose electrons in order to achieve a full valence, or outer shell. What we didn't discuss was where those electrons go or where they come from. Usually, when an atom loses an electron, it is actually giving it to another atom who needs an electron to fill its valence shell. This process of transferring electrons between atoms to fill their valence shell is called ionic bonding, and the compounds formed by ionic bonds are called ionic compounds, or salts. Let's look at some examples of how ionic bonds form. How about we start with sodium and chlorine? The first step is to draw the Lewis dot structure for each element. Remember, we only need to focus on the valence electrons in the Lewis dot structure, and we can determine the number of valence electrons an atom has based on its group in the periodic table. Sodium is in group 1 and has 1 valence electron, so its Lewis dot structure has 1 dot, like this. Chlorine is in the 7th column and has 7 valence electrons. When drawing valence electrons, we place the electrons one at a time, clockwise, around the element symbol until the 5th electron, when we start pairing them up. Chlorine's Lewis dot structure should look like this. In our last lesson, we learned that if an atom has 1, 2, or 3 valence electrons, it wants to lose those electrons. So, in this example, sodium wants to lose its valence electron. Atoms with 5, 6, or 7 valence electrons want to gain electrons, so it can have 8 electrons in its valence shell. In this example, chlorine will gain 1 electron. This is a nice, simple trade. Sodium wants to lose an electron and chlorine wants to gain an electron, so sodium gives its electron to chlorine. Now both atoms have a full valence shell. When sodium lost its electron, it became an ion with a positive 1 charge, and when chlorine gained an electron, it became an ion with a negative 1 charge. As we know, opposite charges attract, so the sodium ion and chlorine ion are attracted to one another, and that attraction is called an ionic bond. To write the chemical formula for this compound, you would write the element symbol for the metal, in this case sodium, then the element symbol for the nonmetal, chlorine. Since we only used one atom of each element, we do not write any subscripts. Let's work through another example. How would potassium and iodine come together to form an ionic compound? First, find each element on the periodic table and draw their Lewis dot structures. Potassium's symbol is K and is located in group 1, and iodine's symbol is I and it is located in group 7. Once we have their Lewis dot structures, let's start transferring electrons. Potassium has one valence electron that it wants to lose, so it gives that one electron to iodine, who needs one more electron to have a full outer shell. Once this transfer happens, potassium becomes an ion with a positive one charge, and iodine becomes an ion with a negative one charge. These opposite charges cause the ions to be attracted to one another, forming an ionic bond. To write the chemical formula for this compound, you write the metal first, K, followed by the nonmetal, I. Since we only used one atom of each element, there are no subscripts, so the formula is KI. What about the compound that forms between magnesium and chlorine? Let's start with the Lewis dot structures. Magnesium is in group 2, so it has 2 valence electrons, and chlorine is in group 7 and has 7 valence electrons. This chlorine atom has space to accept one of magnesium's valence electrons, but magnesium has 2 valence electrons to lose. Any ideas of what we can do to help magnesium out? What if we add a second chlorine atom? Then we can give the second valence electron from magnesium to this new chlorine atom. Do all 3 atoms have full valence shells? Yes! Okay, so let's draw this ionic compound and write its formula. The final drawing for this ionic compound would show one magnesium ion with a positive 2 charge because it lost 2 electrons and 2 chlorine ions, each with a negative 1 charge. As a whole, is the compound neutral? Yes, it is! The positive 2 charge cancels out the 2 separate negative 1 charges to form a neutral compound. How would we write this formula? Well, the metal, magnesium in this case, always comes first, followed by the nonmetal, chlorine. How many magnesium atoms did we use? Just 1, so we don't write a subscript for the Mg. How many chlorine atoms do we need? 2. So we need to write a little number 2 as a subscript for the Cl. So the formula of the compound formed when magnesium and chlorine bond is MgCl2. I think you might be ready to try one on your own. What do you think? What is the formula for the ionic compound formed between sodium and sulfur? Remember, first, draw the Lewis dot structures, then transfer the electrons from the metal to the nonmetal, adding any atoms necessary until all atoms have a full valence shell. Finally, draw the compound using the ions and determine the formula for the compound. Okay, pause the video and give it a try. Welcome back! How did you do? Let's check your work with mine. Did you get the same answer? Don't worry if you're still having trouble with this. You will have more practice in the lesson PDF. Now that we have learned how ionic compounds are formed, it is important to learn how to name them. The naming convention for ionic compounds is pretty straightforward. First, you write the name of the metal, followed by the name of the nonmetal. However, you have to change the ending of the nonmetal so that the name ends in IDE. For some of these elements, like fluorine, that is easy. You just change the N to a D to get fluoride. But for others, like oxygen, it is a little more challenging. Oxygen becomes oxide. Let's practice with the compounds we made earlier in this lesson. How would you name the compound formed between sodium and chlorine? Sodium stays sodium, but chlorine becomes chloride. So we get sodium chloride, which you may know as table salt. What about our second example, potassium and iodine? Potassium iodide. Pause the video and try the last two examples we did, magnesium with chlorine and sodium with sulfur, on your own. Welcome back! Let's check your answers. For magnesium and chlorine, you should have gotten the name magnesium chloride. What about for sodium and sulfur? This one is a little tricky. Sodium sulfide. Don't worry if it is still a little confusing. We will be practicing more in the lesson PDF. As we went through the lesson today, we learned how metals and nonmetals transfer electrons to form ionic bonds, and how to name ionic compounds. In our next lesson, we are going to learn how atoms share electrons to achieve a full valence shell. Until next time, remember, the universe is vast and full of surprises, so never stop exploring. Hey, hey.